New South Wales police have upped the stakes for the capture of the state's most wanted man, offering a $200,000 reward to help track down James Dalamangas. The 48-year-old is wanted in relation to the stabbing murder of George Giannopoulos at a nightclub in Belmore 20 years ago. Police have been unable to locate Dalamangas, who is believed to be living in Greece. Hidden inside a crate of furniture, police have allegedly uncovered close to 70 kilograms of cocaine bound for Sydney streets. Officers say the massive drug haul was discovered in a shipment from South Africa earlier this month and is worth $34 million.
To the blind eye, it looked like it was just a normal crate, and there was 61 packages within that that weighed the 68 kilos of cocaine.
A 45-year-old South African national has been charged with importing a commercial quantity of drugs, which carries a maximum sentence of 25 years to life behind bars. Tony Abbott has slammed a controversial ad from political activist group GetUp, which showed the former Prime Minister ignoring a drowning person's plea for help. Live Tonight political reporter Ellie Walsh. Ellie, GetUp has pulled the ad in the midst of this public backlash.
They have, Belinda. It's the ad they now don't want you to see. After 24 hours, the activist group pulling it offline and issuing an apology after backlash from both the surf life-saving community and politicians. So the commercial there on your screen made a mockery of a drowning swimmer with a fake Tony Abbott chomping away on an onion and simply watching on. This afternoon, the former Prime Minister slammed the organisation GetUp. Also joining him in condemnation was independent candidate Zali Steggall. That's despite the pair going head-to-head for the Sydney seat of Warringah.
GetUp and their candidate ought to hang their heads in shame, because the 150,000-plus surf lifesavers of Australia should be treated with more respect than GetUp did.
I think it was a very poor taste, and I don't support that kind of advertising. I think really everyone needs to focus on policies and the issues and get away from smear campaigns.
Okay, now this afternoon, Tony Abbott won a spot above Zali Steggall on the ballot for the beachside electorate. It's now day 14 of the election campaign. Scott Morrison is in Darwin, as you can see, where he promised a $63 million package for military veterans. Bill Shorten, meanwhile, he is in Townsville, where he was pressed on the controversial Adani coal mine project. It appeared there were that's after it appeared there were conflicting statements by Labor candidates in marginal seats. Today, though, Belinda, he restated Labor's policy, saying there were no plans for a review.
We'll have to leave it there. Thanks for that. Let's go back to Renee Henry in Sri Lanka, where ISIS has claimed responsibility for the Easter terror bombings. Renee, authorities believe this may have been an act of retaliation, you were telling us.
Yes, Belinda, it's the Defence Minister here who's made those claims that the initial investigation has shown that this was a retaliation attack for the Christchurch massacre that killed 50 people. He hasn't, however, pointed to the evidence behind that and says that the investigation is ongoing. About an hour after he made those claims, ISIS released a statement claiming responsibility for the attack and also releasing video, which it says shows the seven suicide bombers pledging allegiance to Islamic State. The authorities here, the officials here, for at least a couple of days now have been speaking of their suspicions that two small homegrown terrorist groups here have foreign links. Perhaps that is now proving true. Jacinda Ardern, the Prime Minister of New Zealand, has weighed in on the claims of the Christchurch links. Have a listen.
I have seen reports of those statements. We haven't received anything officially, nor have we received any intelligence reports that corroborate what has been said in Sri Lanka.
Mass funerals for the dead are continuing right across Sri Lanka, including yesterday afternoon for Melbourne's Manik Suriarachchi and her 10-year-old daughter, Alexandria. We were invited to that funeral by Manik's husband. It was incredibly sad to see him being held up by other loved ones as he watched his wife and his daughter be laid to rest. At that funeral, it was held outside the church, the ceremony itself, and not inside a church, because mourners were too scared to be inside a church in case there was another bombing. And rightly so, while we were there, we were hearing reports from police that they were being told to be on the lookout for a lorry and a van suspected of being laden with explosives that could have been on the roads in the Colombo area. We haven't heard any more on that, so whether that is still out there remains to be seen. And what this is proof of the fact that this is very much still a tense situation, an ongoing situation, as this country goes through so much. Belinda.
All right, thanks, Renee. Renee Henry there with the latest from Sri Lanka. Back home, a Queensland Police property officer has admitted stealing dozens of guns and ammunition he was meant to destroy. Tessa Hardy has the story.
Police found 42 unsecured and untraceable weapons hidden inside the ceiling of a suburban home last year, including 7 working firearms, a silencer, flick knives and capsicum spray. Craig Robert Everett had stolen them. He was employed by the Queensland Police Service as a property officer. It was his job to destroy firearms brought to him, but instead, he says, lax procedures meant he could effortlessly steal them. Not to sell, but simply because he was passionate about gun engineering. He wanted to build weapons. He enjoyed handling, cleaning and checking them. The 34-year-old father pleaded guilty to stealing firearms as a public service employee and received 2 years jail but was immediately paroled. He's also disqualified from holding a weapons license for 5 years.
You've lost your career, your job. Was it worth it? Is there an apology to the community?
This thief's undoing was his own clumsiness. He shot himself in the hand with one of the Glocks and had to call paramedics. He tried to tell them the injury was from an angle grinder, but they spotted his bloodied handprint on the ceiling, and that's what led to the discovery of all of these weapons.
The homicide squad is searching for clues after a woman's body was discovered at Chinatown in Melbourne CBD. Sam Cucciara has the details.
The heart of Melbourne's Chinatown is usually a hive of activity, but today it's been in lockdown for several hours, bordered by crime scene tape. It was a passerby who made the grim discovery just after 6:30 this morning, finding the body of a 33-year-old woman on the corner of a city lane. Paramedics were called, but there was little they could do. While police have not yet revealed exactly how this woman died, homicide squad detectives have now taken charge of this investigation. They've been going door to door searching for any CCTV which may shed light on this death. It's left many locals and traders on edge.
I'm just worried about the safe situation for the Chinatown.
Shocking news, so something that no one would be expecting.
Oh, that's scary. Yeah, it's for Melbourne, it's a bit extreme, isn't it? Yeah, usually it's never happened.
It's unclear whether this woman had any visible signs of injuries when she was found. She'll now undergo a post-mortem as detectives piece together her final movements.
One in two legally blind Australians have been refused service in the last 2 years because of a guide dog being present. That's according to a new survey. The report found cafes and restaurants made up nearly three quarters of the offenders.
Having low vision and blindness is very socially isolating. So to be refused service because of your disability has very negative effect on people with low vision.
Guide Dogs Victoria says improved awareness and education would change the trend.